Hi, I'm Dr. Naftali Serrano, and this is the Behavioral Health Consultation Podcast. I feel like I'm constantly apologizing for not getting these videos out more frequently. I get very nice feedback from people who listen. Unfortunately, my life is a little bit busy these days. But I'm getting one in today, which is awesome. So today's topic is going to be pediatric consults in primary care. And obviously, I can't cover every single eventuality in primary care consults. However, today I want to kind of cut a slice of one of the more common presentations of kids in the primary care setting, specifically with ADHD. Now, typically these consults come to you one of two ways. One is the school nurse perhaps, or school teacher is sending the child, and typically the question is not whether the child has ADHD, but rather how quickly can you get this child on medication. And so that's important to know that that's kind of the question you're getting before you've even seen the child or that the pediatrician's seen the child. So they'll send the child to the pediatrician. The other situation is often the parent frustrated because the school's constantly on them about the child's behavior, and thus they want the child on medication, or they're concerned that the school is pushing medication on them. So that's what we're going to talk about today. Now, there's a lot of nuances to it. What I want to do today is really talk about one of the key core approach or core understandings that I use in working with parents and with their schools, their kids' schools, around this. So we're not going to cover every angle, but this perspective hopefully is a helpful way to kind of help you conceptualize how you might frame a primary care consult, so a good 15 to 30 minute visit with a parent and their child. So, you know, first of all, algorithmically, you're usually kind of beginning with a kind of yes-no medication thing, because that's what the pediatrician is going to want to know. They're going to want to know, do you feel like this kid really does genuinely have ADHD, and is medication indicated in this kind of a situation? I'm not going to go into the nuances of all the assessment that you might want to do. We'll do that in another video. But the idea is that's one of the pieces of the algorithm. Now, regardless of whether you do medication yes, no, you're also then part of the algorithm as well. What would be most helpful from a behavioral standpoint for this child? And some of that might, you know, typically where early behavioral health consultants usually go, for example, is with basic behavior modification. So things like limits and consequences, token systems, charts, that kind of a thing. And that might be a recommendation to the school, might be a recommendation for the parent to implement, depending upon where the problem is behaviorally and what the nature of that problem is. And that's fine for a good number of kids. Unfortunately, frankly, behavior modification works real well for kids who don't struggle with the kinds of things that kids with ADHD struggle with. And that's why oftentimes what you'll find is a lot of resistance to those ideas on the part of the school who might be saying, hey, we've already tried this, or parents who say, hey, we've tried this. And unfortunately, the answer that we often have is, well, you haven't tried it hard enough. And I think that's often not necessarily a very respectful way of approaching it, because I think a lot of times parents do try hard enough, even if it's not perfect. And they understand intuitively when things are kind of not working so well. So that's one way you can go about it. The other way is kind of to work on parent-child interaction type stuff. So working on attachment, working on kind of the even some psychoeducation with the parent around just basic discipline and other strategies. And that can have a lot of merit as well. The only problem with that is it often doesn't kind of strike at the core of the issue, which is usually at school. That's usually where the child is exhibiting the most deficits. Now, the third way here that I'd like to talk the most about today is a way that I was introduced to by a psychiatrist out on the East Coast by the name of Dr. Ross Green. And he wrote this really great book, very accessible book for parents, with a chapter for schools as well. And I've on occasion actually sent the chapter to teachers at schools of some parents. And the name of the book is The Explosive Child. And Dr. Green's approach differs from these other approaches that I've just talked about in that he really outlines the nature of the problem in a fundamentally different way. Whereas these behavior systems look at the nature of the problem as a motivational problem, That is, the child cannot motivate themselves well enough, so we have to implement these limits and consequences or rewards and punishments. Dr. Green's approach is to say the issue is not motivation, the issue is skill deficit, and particularly skill deficit in important areas. Two in particular. One is, he says, chronic inflexibility. It's this idea that life demands flexibility on you. Things change, plans change. And so for a child, often labeled as ADHD, they often have this great difficulty dealing with changes throughout their day, with demands on them to adapt, essentially, to kind of the minute-by-minute happenings of their day. The other major core skill deficit that these children have, he says, is that they have very low frustration tolerance. Again, life demands or challenges kids and us really all day long with different kinds of challenges. It could be a poor interaction with another child, with a teacher, or just being frustrated at the work or not understanding the work that's in front of them, or having to work too hard to work through something to learn it. And what happens then as a result, whether through the chronic inflexibility or the low frustration tolerance, the child then experiences this rush of emotion that leads to a meltdown. And Dr. Green explains it from a neurological perspective, that basically their brain stops thinking. It shuts down. And at that point, the child is just acting and emoting and cannot problem solve, cannot think their way through like other kids might be able to kind of slow some things down and think their way through and potentially come up with some solutions or ways of coping through the things that are causing them to be flexible or causing them to be inflexible or frustrated. So, you know, the key difference here is, again, the issue is not motivation, the issue is skill deficit. So if the issue is skill deficit, then what's the answer? Well, the answer is, well, we want to teach skill deficit, we want to develop these skills. And Dr. Green's book goes through kind of ways of working with parents to help them develop these skills. So what would be some ways to develop these skills? Well, Dr. Green goes through some of these strategies, including teaching parents how to do some basic reflective listening, essentially, to show empathy towards a child and engage the child effectively. So child says, I'm hungry. And you teach the parents to say, so you're hungry. Child says, I don't want to share this toy. Oh, so you don't want to share this toy. So you just basically teach that as a way to both kind of slow the parents' reaction down, to kind of jump in and either consequence, limit, try to solve the problem on their own, and also to connect effectively with the child. One of the other things that then the parent will do is then begin to help the child to create solutions. That is, once they've identified the problem, then the parent can help the child begin to generate solutions in a collaborative fashion. And of course, part of this is also then often negotiation with the child. So, for example, he gives a great example of a kid on their way to his office, and the parent, having learned some of these skills, kind of working on it as they're driving to their office. So the child says from the back seat of the car, I'm hungry, I want some pizza. And then so the parent says, so you're hungry and you want some pizza? Yes, I'm hungry and I want some pizza. And the parent then responds, says, yes, I hear you. You're hungry and you want some pizza. That must be pretty frustrating to be hungry and sitting in a car. And the child says, I'm hungry. Parent then begins to help the child identify what the problem is and says, so on the one hand, you're hungry and you want some pizza. On the other hand, we also have to get to this appointment to see Dr. So-and-so. And often these kids will then escalate at that point, right? Because they sense that, this is a situation that can't be resolved. And the child might respond with, no, I'm hungry, I want some pizza. And the parent can say, oh, hold on a second, I didn't say you couldn't have some pizza. I just said that we have a problem and we want to solve this problem. So let's solve this problem together, you and me. Let's come up with some solutions to this problem. So you might ask the child for some ideas. Well, how do you think we could solve this problem of being hungry, but then on the other hand, we have to make this appointment? If the child can't do it, then the adult would generate those solutions generate potential solutions kind of in a menu format and say, well, you know, I wonder if one of the things we could do is maybe stop off and get some snacks and then continue on our way. And then after we see Dr. Green, then we can go get some pizza. So it's a way, again, of cueing the child to begin problem solving and to not get to that meltdown point right away. So, you know, in the ideal situation, and in the situation that Dr. Green describes, the child is able to then accept this kind of in-between situation of kind of stopping off and doing it. Now, the key piece, though, is not just that process. That process is important. But then what happens over time is, and with this example he gave, what happens is the next time they go to Dr. Green's office, before they get in the car, the child says, oh, I often get hungry on the way to Dr. Green's office. Maybe we should get some food right now. And again, that's the whole idea, that in order to combat these problems of chronic inflexibility and poor frustration tolerance, that we build some skills in so that the child can compensate for these deficits and learn how to cope their way through them. Now, this approach to me makes so much more sense than a lot of the behaviorally oriented approaches, because it really, to me, strikes at the heart of these kids' experience and strikes at what's really going on within them. Now, it demands some flexibility and it demands some skills on the part of the parent and the teachers in the schools. And a lot more schools are teaching this kind of approach as far as behavior management goes. So not all this would be foreign to schools and teachers in your area, potentially. But even so, you know, again, I have sent these chapters off to teachers on more than one occasion. So this is an approach that I use. It's very teachable in a 15 to 30 minute format. It's an approach that parents can really grasp on. And changes their perspective of their child from a child with a label, with a brain disorder, to a child with skill deficits, with things that can be taught. In fact, I'll often, in the session, say, you know, one good way to think about how to work through these situations with your child is to think about the things that you and I do during the day to manage our frustration, to manage situations where we are asked to be flexible. And parents then gravitate to say, yeah, I can do that because I know how to manage my frustration. I know that I get frustrated, but then I do things. I solve problems. I negotiate my way through the day, essentially. So, just kind of a perspective on these pediatric consults. There's obviously a lot more, but we'll leave it this for today. Thanks very much for listening. Hopefully a podcast coming soon. For the Behavioral Health Consultation Podcast, I'm Dr. Naftali Serrano. See you soon.